I've compared the last five generations of Intel i7 processor in both games and applications to help you find out if it's time to upgrade or if you can save some money getting an older model. These are the differences in specs between these five generations of Intel i7 processors. The main differences are, of course, the core and thread counts, cache sizes, and clock speeds. Though the speeds aren't everything, as there are, of course, various IPC improvements each generation. The newest 12th gen also changes things up by adding efficiency cores, which is how they've been able to get the newest i7 to a 20-thread part. This is the system that's been used for all testing. So the same NZXT case, MSI Core Liquid S360 AIO, and Noctua NT-H2 thermal paste have been used for fair thermal results. However, the motherboard and RAM have been changed as required depending on the platform. You can find all hardware that's been tested in the description below the video. Another difference is that Intel's 12th gen was the first to add DDR5 support. And while DDR4 is also supported with some motherboards, I've only got a DDR5 board, so that's what I've used. Now, the main reason why I've only looked at 5 processors is because these are what's currently supported with Windows 11. Sure, I probably could have made Windows 11 work with older platforms, but I also don't have a 7700K and older anyway. So I've limited the testing to the last 5 i7s. Alright, let's get straight into some application benchmarks, followed by power draw, thermals, then afterwards we'll look at gaming as well as cost per frame value. Let's start out with Cinebench R23, as it's an easy way to get a general idea of both single-threaded and multi-threaded performance. I've got the newest 12th gen at the top, followed by 11th, 10th, 9th, and 8th gen underneath. So sorted to newest to oldest down the bottom. Performance gets better with each newer generation, as you'd expect. However, the most recent 12th gen is clearly offering the biggest improvement. Not only is the multi-core score with the i7-12700K 54% higher than the 11th gen i7-11700K just below it, despite only having a 25% higher thread count, but the single-threaded performance is 25% higher too. The biggest gen-on-gen improvement out of this selection of processors in this test. Linux kernel compilation is the only test I've done on Linux rather than Windows 11. This is a multi-threaded test, and as for the most part, the thread count of the i7 has improved over the years, so it's no surprise to see the newer options completing the task faster. 10th and 11th gen were both 8-core 16-thread parts, and while the jump to 11th gen is generally considered pointless, the 11700K was still completing this 12% faster than the 10700K before it. But then the 12700K was 38% faster than the 11700K, a much better improvement in less than 12 months. Blender was tested with the Open Data benchmark. This is another multi-threaded workload, and the longer classroom test was only 6% faster on 9th gen compared to 8th gen, while 11th gen was 12% faster than 10th gen before it. Though 10th gen was 38% faster than 9th gen because this is when Intel added hyperthreading back to i7. Again, 12th gen had the largest gen-on-gen gain, completing the test 44% faster than 11th gen, which came out earlier in the same year. The V-Ray benchmark is another heavy multi-threaded rendering workload, and 12th gen was scoring 41% higher than 11th gen just before it, which was clearly the biggest jump out of the last 5 generations. Again, there's a reasonable boost going from 9th to 10th gen because 10th gen brought back hyperthreading, but after that, 11th gen was only 14% higher than 10th gen. The Corona benchmark also uses the processor to render out a scene, but this time the 9th gen 9700K was actually slower than the 8700K, which I'm guessing is due to it having 4 fewer threads as it lacks hyperthreading. This wasn't an issue in any of the previous tasks, but here it seems that 6 cores 12 threads beats 8 cores 8 threads, though only by 5 seconds. Again, the difference between 10th and 11th gen was much smaller compared to the gains on offer with 12th gen. Handbrake was used to convert one of my 4K 60fps laptop review videos to 1080p. This workload also relies on more cores and threads, though we're back to seeing each gen offer an improvement here. The 12700K was able to complete the task 41% faster, quite a big difference if this is a production workload you're waiting on. And again, the biggest generational improvement out of the last 5 that we're testing. Adobe Premiere was tested with the Puget Systems benchmark tool, and this tests video editing tasks like exporting, playback, and more. Once more, highest score with the 12700K at the top, which was 20% ahead of the 11700K before it. The gap was a little smaller in DaVinci Resolve, another video editing suite, where the 12700K was scoring 16% higher than the 11700K. But hey, it's still nearly a 250-point increase. While 11th gen was only 100 points ahead of 10th gen below it. I also usually test Adobe Photoshop, however Windows 11 plus Intel 12th gen has known issues that prevented the test from running. So rather than just not include Photoshop data, I figured the other four generations were still useful and thought this helps illustrate that 12th gen is still a new platform with some teething issues that need to be fixed. Now for some office tasks. This is basically the new PC mark and covers Microsoft Excel, Word, PowerPoint, and Outlook. And the general trend, as before, is that 12th gen offers the biggest boost compared to the previous generational jumps. I've used 7-Zip to test compression and decompression speeds, and like many other workloads tested, this saw big gains with 11th gen, though not the largest. The biggest jump was from 9th to 10th gen. Prior to Alder Lake, AMD's Ryzen was typically far ahead of Intel here, but now with these improvements, they're closer together. AES encryption and decryption had the biggest improvements with 12th gen. 8th, 9th, and 10th gen were all essentially the same, until 11th gen offered a 22% boost. But then 12th gen destroys 11th gen with a 53% boost. I don't personally rely on Geekbench scores at all, but you guys ask for it, and the results are fairly similar to what we saw earlier with Cinebench. Here's how much better the 9th gen i7-9700K was compared to the 8th gen i7-8700K just before it. So only Corona was doing better on 8th gen as discussed earlier. On average, the 9th gen chip was 7% faster than 8th gen, at least out of these specific workloads. These tests include a number of random single and multi-threaded tests, so this average only applies to this selection of tests. It's not fair to apply it to the processor in general. If we instead compare the 10th gen i7-10700K against the 9th gen i7-9700K, well, now we're looking at a larger 21% gain with 10th gen, and this is because it enabled hyper-threading, which was missing from 9th gen for some reason. I guess they needed an excuse to sell 10th gen. Then after that, the jump with 11th gen was about 13% ahead of 10th gen, again, only when comparing these specific applications. While generally not much of a difference, the single-threaded tests towards the top did see fairly reasonable gains with 11th gen. 12th gen is where the magic happens though. We're seeing the i7-12700K nearly 33% ahead of the i7-11700K in these same tests. The biggest difference when comparing each generation to the one that came out after it. Now, although 12th gen did have the biggest generational improvement, what I've done so far is compare each generation to the next, and it's unlikely that most people are gonna be upgrading from one i7 to the next one every time one comes out. So let's find out how the older i7s compare against the newer 12700K and find out if it's time to upgrade. If we compare 8th gen to 12th gen in the same applications, well, the 12700K has a massive 95% lead. While we only saw smaller differences comparing between each generation, things really start to add up by the time you look back between five different generations. 12th gen still has a good lead over 9th gen too, with the 12700K performing around 82% better in these tests. The 12700K was then around 51% ahead of the 10th gen i7. As the 10th gen added hyperthreading, this closed the gap a bit. And as we saw before, 12th gen is then 33% ahead of 11th gen just before it. So we've established that the newest 12th gen i7 performs the best. But despite this, in Blender, it actually wasn't drawing as much power from the wall when compared to 11th gen. Now, it is important to note that I'm measuring total system power draw from the wall here, and there are some component changes between 11th and 12th gen, including motherboard and RAM. Still though, the fact that 12th gen isn't using more power than 11th gen while also completing this particular Blender task 44% faster really drives home how much of an improvement Alder Lake is, or how crap Rocket Lake was, take your pick. Now, although 12th gen was using less power than 11th gen, the 12700K was still running 11 degrees Celsius warmer compared to any other i7 that came before it. Personally, I have absolutely zero issue running at these temps long term, but I have a fairly beefy new 360mm AIO, so if you're using an older cooler with say 9th gen and you get LGA 1700 mounting hardware, you might want to monitor the temperatures. 12th gen processors are a different size and more rectangular than those that came before it, so ideally you're going to want a cooler that better covers more of the IHS. Alright, now let's look at some games. I'm going to compare all 5 processors in 10 different games at 2 different resolutions. Far Cry 6 was tested with the game's benchmark. I've got the 1080p results on the bottom half of the graph and the 1440p results above, again with older CPUs down the bottom moving up to newer processors above. In this game, we can see there are performance improvements with newer processors, even at the higher 1440p resolution, something which isn't the case in a number of games as we'll see. At 1080p, 9th gen was reaching 17% higher average FPS than 8th gen, 10th gen was 12% ahead of 9th gen, 11th gen was just 4% ahead ahead of 10th gen, while 12th gen was 9% ahead of 11th gen before it. Even the 1% lows from 12th gen are ahead of the average FPS from 8th gen, 5 generations prior. So again, things add up much more if you're upgrading on longer cycles. Cyberpunk 2077 was tested in the same part of the game on all 5 processors. In this one, the performance difference is basically nothing when it comes to the higher 1440p resolution, at least in terms of average FPS. Though there is a little more change noted in the 1% lows from 10th gen and newer. These 1% low differences are also noted at the lower 1080p resolution. Going from 9th to 10th gen boosts 1% low performance by 26%, so a much more stable experience on 10th gen or newer. In terms of average FPS though, 12th gen was only 15% faster than 8th gen, not a whole lot for a 5 generation jump. Red Dead Redemption 2 was tested with the game's benchmark. At both resolutions, 10th gen was actually performing better than 11th gen. Granted, the difference is within margin of error at the higher 1440p resolution, but still goes to show that in some games, 11th gen was kind of a step back. This results in 12th gen reaching 9% higher average FPS than 11th gen before it, 7% ahead of 11th gen, 20% ahead of 9th gen, and 27% ahead of 8th gen. The differences were smaller at 1440p as we're more GPU bound, but the 12700K was still able to get us a 17% higher average frame rate compared to the 8700K. Microsoft Flight Simulator was tested in the Sydney Landing Challenge, and also saw the 10th gen i7-10700K outperforming the newer i7-11700K, at least in terms of average FPS, as the 1% lows were ahead with the newer 11th gen chip. That weirdness aside, 12th gen was offering the best result, and at 1080p was 30% ahead of 8th gen, 18% ahead of 9th gen, 9% ahead of 10th gen, and 11% ahead of 11th gen. Watch Dogs Legion was tested with the game's benchmark, similar to what we saw in Cyberpunk earlier. The 1% lows get some nice improvements once we go from 9th to 10th gen, so presumably this game and others may benefit from more than 8 threads. At least 11th gen was actually doing better than 10th gen before at this time, and again the newest 12700K was doing the best as you'd expect. Control is a GPU heavy game, which is likely why we're seeing some of the smallest differences in this game out of all 10 titles tested. Best case, the 12th gen processor was only able to offer a 5% higher average frame rate compared to 8th gen at the lower 1080p resolution, so just goes to show that in some games like this, a CPU upgrade isn't really going to help. You could definitely save money with a cheaper older generation. Now let's get into the weirder results. Rainbow Six Siege was tested with the game's benchmark, and while everything looks about how you'd expect at 1080p, the 1440p results were a bit less consistent. 10th gen was actually giving me the highest average frame rate, and sure, it's only a small difference, but still it helps illustrate that at higher resolutions, you definitely don't need the latest and greatest. The differences were quite large at 1080p. The 12700K was reaching a 50% higher average frame rate compared to the 8700K here, or a much higher 122% improvement in the 1% lows. So for competitive games like this at lower resolutions, a CPU upgrade might actually make more sense. Assassin's Creed Valhalla was also tested with the game's benchmark, and the results were just all over the place here. The 8th and 9th gen chips were actually performing the best at both resolutions, at least in terms of average frame rates, and then generally things declined at higher thread counts. So perhaps this is just one of the benefits from fewer threads or something. F1 2021 was also a bit weird. The 1080p results look relatively normal, but then 1440p is a mixed bag, with again 8th and 9th gen coming out ahead of the newer processors when it came to average frame rate. It's not a big difference, but it was consistently measurable as I took the averages of 5 test runs for each of these results. Shadow of the Tomb Raider was again tested with the game's benchmark, and again 1080p was looking fine, progressively improving with newer CPUs as you'd expect. But once more, the 1440p results were a bit of a mess, with 9th gen actually doing the best. Again, not exactly sure why, perhaps some games just work better with fewer available threads. I know we've seen this in the past, and some people actually disable hyperthreading for some games to get a speed boost, but that's not something I've personally experimented with. Here are the average frame rates for all 5 processors at both 1080p and 1440p resolutions. At 1080p, we can see that on average, there's an improvement stepping up to each generation, though the changes between 10th and 11th gen were much smaller compared to the rest. The differences are then smaller at the higher 1440p resolution, which is to be expected as we're more GPU bound here, but the newer i7s are still able to offer a boost, although the differences between 9th, 10th, and 11th gen are like one frame on average. So for 1440p gaming, if you've already got a 9th gen 9700K system, there's not much point upgrading, as the 12700K is only 3% faster, but for 1080p, there would be a larger 17% performance improvement. Here's how things look in terms of value once we factor in current prices at at Newegg. Right now, the oldest 8th gen i7-8700K is actually the worst value, because it's the second most expensive at $400. This is generally the case with older CPUs if you're buying them new. When they're not made anymore, stock becomes more limited. So price goes up, though there is also the secondhand market. Anyway, 8th gen aside, 12th gen seems to be quite a bit worse value compared to 9th, 10th, and 11th gen options, as it's about $80 more expensive. And this is only taking into account CPU prices. If we were to also consider the new Z690 motherboards and DDR5 RAM I tested with, then 12th gen would end up as even worse value. So yeah, it does perform the best, but you've got to pay more to get it. The value is a bit different if we instead use one of the applications tested earlier. This graph shows that the 12th gen i7 was offering the best value in terms of Cinebench R23 performance, both in single core and multi-core. So basically, for more productivity style workloads compared to gaming, there is more value to be had with the newer generation. But again, this is only factoring CPU cost rather than entire platform cost. So there's definitely less of a difference when it comes to gaming when comparing Intel's last 5 i7 processors, at least compared to the productivity workloads that we looked at earlier. In games, CPU choice matters far less at high resolutions like 1440p, and if you're going up to 4K, then it would matter even less. But at 1080p, depending on the game, we could see some pretty big improvements going up to a newer version. From the gaming data that I've collected, if you're already on 10th or 11th gen, then it's probably not really worth upgrading to 12th gen just for the gaming improvement. But if you're also after some productivity boosts, then 12th gen could be worthwhile. If you are just gaming with either 8th or 9th gen, well, it could be worth upgrading to 12th gen, as in some cases there were some pretty big gains even in gaming. At the end of the day though, even if you do have one of these older i7s, it depends on how your system's actually running. If you're satisfied with the performance coming out of it, then there's no need to upgrade. You only really need to upgrade if your system's starting to slow down and not perform how you want it to. So if that's the case for you, well, now you've got the data to see which i7 you should upgrade to. Now, of course, Intel is by no means the only CPU maker in town. Check out this video next if you want to see how the i7-12700K compares against AMD's Ryzen 9 5900X. And make sure you're subscribed for when AMD refresh their processors with their new V-cache. I'll be comparing those against Intel in early 2022 once they're available.